mechanistically how mammals operate at different temperatures to help make better predictions for vulnerability of species to climate change. So I feel like Nicole gave a really good introduction to my work, thank you Nicole, when she was had the two thermal performance curves up with the bass and the salmon and kind of the interactions there. So I'll give a bit of detail on how this works. So these were developed mostly for lizards. They work for a lot of other species, but it was developed for ectothermic species where you have this nice relationship between performance and ambient temperature. And then you have this idea of tolerance range, so they can live at all these temperatures, but they're happier around the optimum. And that shape changes for different species. So what you get in temperate species, so one of our local amphibians, is something like this, where they have a relatively wide thermal tolerance breadth. And potentially with climate warming, they're just going to go further along the curve and be happy. But in tropical species that have a more narrow tolerance range to start with, they might be in trouble as temperatures warm. So this has all been established for the ectothermic literature, and a lot of people are trying to find a way to do this for mammals and birds. The problem with mammals and birds, or endotherms, is that we kind of cheat and maintain our body temperature using chemical, biochemical means and energy. So our relationship between ambient temperature, body temperature, and performance is a lot more complicated. And so what I'm hoping to do while I'm here in Maine is start taking the ectothermic framework for predicting vulnerability, and this is a really excellent paper if anyone needs one, and transfer it to endotherms. And so just a quote from this paper is that overall an evaluation of vulnerability of proxies for endotherms required further investigation. Perhaps the first step is developing a full mechanistic understanding of factors that increase endotherm vulnerability to warming. And for that, we need to know a bit better how endotherms respond to high temperatures, how they respond to variable temperatures, and so on and so forth. And surprisingly, despite years of studying the field, we still don't know as much as we do for lizards. I also do a lot of work on hibernation and how the ability of mammals to cheat by dropping their body temperature and metabolism in different areas and kind of a global perspective, but I don't have time to go into this today. So if anyone wants to know about global patterns and heterothermy in mammals, you can come see me after this. And so what I'm going to start doing while I'm here is taking a couple of study species and getting a really good picture of how they relate to climate. And what's great about Maine and the climate climate barrier within the state is we have a lot of species, mammalian species, that are at the southern edge of their range, as well as at their northern edge. So my first grad student is going to be looking at flying squirrels and using a combination of body temperature and metabolic rate. It's going to get a picture of how they operate with regards to temperature and how much temperature is playing in the sort of move up of the southern species in the state. So I've got the climb up sign, so I'll stop now, but I just wanted to do a shameless self-promotion. I'm doing a new grad seminar that's going to be a survey introduction to One Health and the Environment. So there's about 15 slots. If any grad students are interested, please let me know.
That you use the word cheating for evolutionary adaptation to thermal regulation.
Yeah, I guess it's sort of, if you're gonna save energy, it's more what it was, but yeah. I tend to think of it as that. And what's fun is recently, so it used to be the thought that mammals were always, had high constant body temperatures, and torpor and hibernation were a weird adaptation. But it turns out it's probably the ancestral condition was to go torpid. And in order to survive the K-PG mass extinction and the 9 months of nothing after the asteroid hit, hibernation would have been really useful. And so now there's a lot of papers in physiology coming out with, well, we expected the species to go torpid, but they didn't. It's fun that that's been shifting recently. Well, thank you very much.
CCI in School of Earth and Climate Sciences, and I'm also the state climatologist. What I want to do next couple minutes, just give you a brief overview of work that I've been involved with in the past year, year and a half. It stems from funding that was received from the USAID to produce a climate case study of the country Mali. You may wonder what Mali has to do with North Atlantic. Well, it's linked by the basin-wide circulation. And in conducting this project on Mali's climate, it became clear from the literature, previous work that had been done, that there was a distinct association between the West African monsoon, North Atlantic sea surface temperatures, and as you can see from the title, volcanic activity. So this paper here that I am working on with Paul and others, what we're trying to do, and it's a manuscript that will be submitted very shortly, we're trying to flesh out the association between decade-scale sea surface temperature variability in North Atlantic and volcanic activity. There's a literature base, and I note the primary hypotheses that explain the variability. The leading paradigm is that this, what we would call the Atlantic multi-decadal oscillation, the index is shown here, and that index is produced from a basin-wide average of sea surface temperature that's been detrended and then normalized. The leading paradigm is that it's an oscillation of some sort linked to overturning in the ocean. Numerous works have noted possible association with solar variability, volcanic activity, and also important feedback systems such as Wang et al. who show that dust flux off Africa correlates very strongly with the AMO and sea surface temperatures in the tropics. And also a paper that came out just in the last couple of years, Clement et al., they make the case that the AMO could result from stochastic forcing from the middle latitude atmosphere, and they say no linkage to overturning. And they also don't mention volcanic activity. Well, down here is the Nasigis aerosol optical depth record. And this is for the northern hemisphere from a variety of different proxies for aerosol loading in the stratosphere. And we can see that cool intervals across the North Atlantic correspond pretty well with episodes of explosive volcanic activity. These numbers correspond to particular eruptions. For example, this is the 1883 eruption of Krakatoa, 1902 eruption of Santa Maria, and over here is Pinatubo. So in short, the paper ties together these existing hypotheses, and we show that they can all be linked together by recognizing that explosive volcanic activity alters the thermal gradient across the hemisphere from aerosols going to lower stratosphere over the tropics, increases the polar temperature gradient, induces NAO, North Atlantic Oscillation plus type patterns, which is invigorated circulation. That part's already in the literature as well. But recognizing that the sea surface temperature dipole pattern that forms between these AMO modes, it's linked to atmospheric circulation, in particular a strengthening of the Icelandic low, climatological feature. More storms draw cold flow out of the Labrador Sea into the subpolar region. Intensified circulation produces more northerly flow here, enhanced upwelling. Easterlies draw dust in. And here's an animation from satellite imagery. There's a plume of dust coming off Africa, changes the albedo, cools sea surface temperatures, and affects the hydrological cycle. And last, I'll clam up. Here's sea surface temperature beneath across the subpolar gyre south of Greenland. 2015, the SSTs plummeted following the eruptions of Nabro, Grimsvötn, Tolbuchek. Those eruptions constitute the largest stratospheric aerosol injection since the Pinatubo eruption. So we're making the case that this was a volcanic response. Thank you.
Sean, does it matter where, what latitude the volcanic eruption is?
The biggest impact is low latitude, of course, because it has a potential for the global dispersion. The high latitude eruptions, in the literature, it seems to indicate that they can have a more localized effect, say, across the North Atlantic. But a major eruption can nudge the system towards a cold state. That appears to come from the low latitude eruptions. The Navarro eruption of 2011, there's a paper that came out the year after by Roebuck et al. And they showed that the timing, the seasonal timing was just right. It's an eruption occurred in East Africa, and the dust got entrained into, the material got entrained into the monsoonal circulation, and that pushed into the stratosphere, and then the cloud spread. And but I don't think the climatic importance of that has been recognized. If we're right, we're speculating that the cooling in the North Atlantic the last couple of years is possibly linked to that, but it seems to be consistent so far. Okay. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Ellen Enderlin. I'm research faculty at CCI in Earth and Climate Sciences. I'm really happy that Pete brought up Bukaki this morning, and that glacier retreated really quickly over the course. So retreated, what, 35 kilometers in less than 1,000 years, you said? Which is really fast retreat, and that Peter brought up that there's a lake there, and that might influence this. Because I'm sort of looking at the same processes going on, except I'm looking at glaciers that terminate in the ocean. And the glacier I've been focusing a lot on lately is Columbia Glacier here in Alaska. So here's a little star showing you where it is. This glacier was stable out on this marine shoal that it built. It says here 1952 to 1980, but new research has shown it was stable out there for about 900 years. And then the glacier started this really rapid period of retreat through this fjord. You can see in the satellite image, this is just showing you the retreat here in a different sort of scale, different perspective. So you can see the glacier retreated really quickly, and then actually in the mid-2000s, it split into these two separate glaciers here, which I say Post is the smaller one, Columbia is the larger one. And since that time period, shown in this little figure here, the glaciers have done totally different things. And I find this to be really interesting because this tells us that the glaciers are responding differently despite experiencing the same sort of climate forcing. And this whole cycle might seem like something that's really sort of monumental and it could be caused by climate, but actually glaciers go through these cycles naturally. You don't have to have climate forcing in order to trigger this really massive and rapid retreat. So if you look at these figures here, these are showing you that you have a glacier that terminates in the ocean. It builds up a terminal moraine here as it's flowing out into the ocean and pushing sediment out in front of it. That moraine causes the water depth to decrease. It prevents more icebergs from calving, and that allows the terminus to advance out into the water. So over time, this glacier keeps advancing and advancing. And after a while, if it retreats off that moraine, it retreats really, really rapidly all the way back to this beginning state. So it's a very long advance phase. It can be hundreds of years, and a really rapid retreat, order of tens of years. And we've seen that at Columbia. We saw this really, really rapid retreat. I have some more terminus positions shown on here. And if we look at the terminus positions, that's what I have shown now in this figure. Post is in red, Columbia is in yellow. We see that Post is behaving independently of air temperature. It just has this linear retreat pattern that's dictated by the geometry of the glacier. Columbia has a different signal. We can see little periods of seasonal oscillations here, but it's also retreating overall. So what's really interesting, and I don't expect you to be able to look at all of these figures, is that we see that there is seasonal acceleration here that does coincide with air temperatures. Glaciers are actually flowing the fastest in the winter, and that's because their subglacial hydrologic network collapses, causes them to have high water pressures that allow them to slide along. So they move really quickly in the winter. So you're looking at speeds here, which are up to 8 meters per day. And we see that in general, the Columbia terminus sort of follows that pattern too, but not always. So it's not that we're seeing that these two things, the seasonal acceleration and the terminus retreat, are linked, which you expect to see at most glaciers. So this is really telling me that the geometry of these glaciers is incredibly important, and they don't actually care that much about what climate is doing right now. So this is a really important thing for us to consider. It tells us that geometry is something that's really critically important. And I will say for the glacial geomorphologists, that really should be something that's taken into consideration, because not all the glaciers are going to behave the same way under climate forcing. And it could be because they have the same climate forcing, but they have different geometries, like the presence of a lake out the front. And I think that is all I have. Oh. And I just have some two nice photos here. This is the glacier when it was really, really advanced. And then this is a similar sort of perspective here where it was retreated, and it's even farther back from that now. So we're seeing rapid change, tens of kilometers of retreat in decades right now. So with that, I'll just take any questions.
That seems to go along very well, would you say, that is there's several other mechanisms in there that enter into that site.
And there seems to be a huge sediment flux that's coming off of the glaciers. I just read a recent paper that came out showing that it's really widely dispersed, though, so it goes all along this entire fjord. So it doesn't appear as though it's being concentrated right at the glacier termini, and that could possibly be why the glaciers aren't able to advance. They're still just waiting to develop these shoals, and they're still thinning and retreating in response to this long-term signal.
Long before you were born, but it happens that several members of our institute were involved in pioneering studies of marine-based ice sheets and how they ice behave in the presence of oceans and so forth. And one of the things that turned out to be important, I'm not one of them, but I remember hearing a lot of discussions. One thing that was important were things like changing sea level, which could actually have something to do with climate. So do you think that's a possibility? That's something that's important?
So I don't think on the time scales that we're looking at now that that's what's triggering it. That is something that people talk about where, let's say if all of Western Antarctica collapsed suddenly, that would raise sea level by 6 meters, and then that could be enough to destabilize glaciers elsewhere. But these glaciers are actually pretty insensitive to that sort of forcing. They're more sensitive to changes in ocean temperature than they would be in actual the level of the ocean. Okay, thank you, and I'll move on.
So hi everyone, my name is Aaron Strong. I'm an assistant professor of marine policy in the School of Marine Sciences and a cooperating assistant professor in the Institute. My work focuses primarily on climate change policy, both adaptation policy and what makes climate change adaptation policies effective, and mitigation policy, and I also work on ocean acidification management. And I want to take the opportunity of this update to introduce a specific new research initiative that I'm launching that focuses on international climate change policy. So the title of my talk is The Oceans and International Climate Policy, Oceans Governance After Paris. So if we think about our global climate policy regime, it started in 1992. This was when we had the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. And one of the lines, one of the goals of this Framework Convention, which under which Kyoto and Paris and Copenhagen and all these other big meetings have happened, was to promote sustainable management and promote and cooperate in the conservation and enhancement as appropriate of sinks and reservoirs of all greenhouse gases not controlled by the Montreal Protocol, including biomass, forests, and oceans, as well as all other terrestrial, coastal, and marine ecosystems. So ocean carbon sinks were included under the Framework Convention. This is a list of all the other agreements that were discussed and negotiated after 1992. There's not a single mention of the oceans in all of these. Not one. It's not once mentioned in all of these agreements, including the Kyoto Protocol. Now, when we got to Paris, Paris took a really different approach than Kyoto. It's bottom-up. All the countries of the world made their emissions reduction pledges on their own as opposed to coming together and agreeing from a top-down approach that these are what the emissions reduction commitments are going to be. And that's had some significant effects. One of them is in this bottom-up spirit of organizing, 22 countries joined right before Paris a Because the Ocean Declaration to support action on climate change and oceans. And they had three specific goals. These are the countries involved. Pledge to support the proposal for a special report from the IPCC, to affirm a commitment to reinforce ocean resilience by meeting the targets agreed under the UN Sustainable Development Goal, SDG 14, which is having a meeting in June in 2017 that I and two of my graduate students will be attending, and in keeping with the sense of urgency that is high time to promote an ocean action plan under the UNFCCC starting in 2016, we shall continue to meet as a group to address these challenges. So in other words, in the move into Paris, there was a real push to try to incorporate an agenda for consideration of oceans in terms of climate mitigation as a carbon sink, their role in climate regulation, which we all know about, and the role of ocean resources and their resilience to climate change, which has been a theme that we've been talking about with organisms and their thermal responses. How do we coordinate all that information and use it to inform international climate policy? It hadn't been done yet. So finally in Paris, there was a lot of celebration because we got a note of the importance of ensuring the integrity of all ecosystems, including oceans. But I think what's more important is to think about what Paris means for the oceans. So first of all, under the Paris Agreement, all of the pledges get us from about 3.6 degrees of warming to 2.7 degrees of warming. And current pH change has been about 0.1 units, and business as usual in the absence of Paris would be by 2100, 0.4 units. With Paris, we get to about 0.3 units, although I'm working with a group ongoing to evaluate some of that. So this is what Paris gets us on terms of these scientific metrics using standard IPCC scenarios, which may not be the best things to use. But Paris also got us the advancement of this new oceans agenda. The IPCC is producing a special report on oceans and climate, and there's a call out right now for authors for that report. There is a major ocean governance conference that is happening in June, and my group will be there. And there is now an ocean action plan that was formed in March of this year to advance ocean action under the UNFCCC. And they have three specific priorities: marine protected areas and climate change and resilience, ocean acidification with the Global Ocean Acidification Observing Network, and how to consider blue carbon in coastal and pelagic ecosystems. And this is what I want to draw your attention to, because this is why it's so critical to have scientists participating in these processes. This is a map of global anthropogenic CO2 uptake. The North Atlantic is a major carbon sink. There is consideration of incorporating those kinds of carbon sinks into individual country ledgers, into individual country accounts of their emissions, so that out to the exclusive economic zone, those carbon sinks would be included, even though we're not necessarily responsible for them. That would be a game changer, and we see this in the country pledges, that they start including pelagic carbon sinks. What we need is a concerted effort, as we start writing the rules of how to implement Paris, to pay attention to ocean carbon biogeochemistry and how it's been incorporated. Right now it's being led by NGOs. So these are the research questions for this new initiative, and one of the first and foremost, I won't read them all, is what scientific information is regarded as salient, legitimate, and credible within the ocean climate nexus moving into the next UNFCCC agreement? So there's a real opportunity to participate in all of these. We'll be at the oceans meeting in New York at the UN, and we'll be at the next meeting of the UNFCCC, the next conference of the parties in Bonn, Germany, in November. So if you're at all interested in getting involved in UNFCCC work, I'd love to collaborate and chat with people. Thanks. Yeah, Ivan.
Aaron, so including the blue carbon in individual countries' commitment,
yep.
what was the, or maybe you said it and I missed it, what's the implication there that undercuts what the level of their commitment needs to be, or that's a new opportunity?
I think it's a really dangerous opportunity. Right now they're not included, and so what we get are countries like the United Arab Emirates suddenly declaring that all of their blue carbon sinks should be included in their ledgers, and that mitigates or offsets other emissions and makes them look less bad, and their commitments are lower. That's, I think, part of the concern, is that blue carbon is a real thing. It's our stocks in coastal ecosystems. But as this fuzzy line with pelagic ecosystems gets blurred and people start talking about any DIC drawdown as a carbon sink that we can, you know, take credit for as a country, that becomes more problematic. Yeah.
Definition, what is blue carbon?
So blue carbon is the carbon stored and sequestered in coastal ecosystems. Traditionally, that's been in seagrass beds, mangroves, salt marshes, and tidal flats. Those ecosystems sequester a lot of carbon and have high rates of burial in their sediments. They also trap allotinous carbon. And so just like forests are carbon sinks. So forests have been in all of those agreements where oceans weren't considered. Forests were front and center, right? We have all these payment programs. We have all these things for forest carbon. So now there's been a new interest in, well, what about coastal ecosystems and carbon? but there hasn't been a clear enough definition, and it started to migrate into calculations of photosynthetic uptake rates, for example.
Unfortunately,
yeah.
I have to keep going.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Cindy Eisenhower. I'm an assistant professor of anthropology and at the Climate Change Institute, and I also have collaborating status with the School of Economics and the Mitchell Center. So many of you who know me know that I have been long interested in methods of accounting that we use to account for greenhouse gas emissions and what those methods mean politically in terms of the attribution of responsibility on a global level. So that's an ongoing project of mine. In fact, Aaron and I, along with Anna McGinn in the back, one of our students just submitted a paper on that topic. But today I'm going to bring it down a level of the scale and tell you a little bit about a new project that I'm really excited about, because it allows me to bridge this focus on climate mitigation with a focus on climate adaptation. So, should I have a clicker? Oh, yeah, I do. Okay, so in 2009, the US EPA modified the traditional sectoral approach that we usually use to account for emissions. And they looked at the same number of emissions, but approached it from a systems-based approach. And what we see here is that when we do this, we can attribute about 42% of greenhouse gas emissions in the US to the procurement of goods and food that people buy. And so what this did is it started to put a lot more emphasis on materials, right? The amount of materials that we're producing and consuming every year, and a lot more focus on recovering those materials, moving more toward a circular economy where there's not so much waste within the system. So we see an increase over time in recovery. So this is just from plastics, right? That we're recovering more plastics, right? We're making bottles thinner, for example. But at the same time, and we are improving, right? We're becoming more efficient. But at the same time, we're producing more and more bottles, right? So all of those gains are essentially cannibalized. So we see the creation of these waste hierarchies where we are seeing more pushed away from landfilling and trying to get people to reduce. And you'll see in the second slot there, the reuse behaviors. So, and this is because we see global materials use are increasing much faster than population, right? So it's not necessarily, population is certainly important, but materials use is as well. And the real shame is that 90% of materials are buried or burned within a year of their production. And we see that this has severe consequences for waste, methane production, all sorts of things. So the background to this proposal is that, yes, recovery is increasing, efficiency is increasing, but is it enough? Because consumption is increasing so drastically. So the arrows are essentially getting bigger in the circular economy. So my work clearly has ecological implications, but it also has, the literature points to significant economic value associated with extending product lifetimes, also strong social value. I can't go into all of these right now, but the project is primarily driven by very sincere and widespread policy enthusiasm for increasing product lifetimes and reuse right now. We see it in lots of places. Many of you might have seen Sweden is now giving tax breaks to people who repair their goods rather than buy new. But I was really interested in this, so we see all sorts of city-based levels, national levels to increase reuse, repair cafes, materials exchanges at the industrial level, tool libraries, so this is part of the sharing or the collaborative economy. But I was really interested in this, particularly in Maine. I moved here about 3.5 years ago, and I was just blown away by the vibrancy of the reuse economy here in the state. And so I'll just share some quick early data with you. I now have data to prove it. So we did some, ran some location quotients looking at employment within the reuse sector and found, as you can see in the dark colors, Maine is has one of the most vibrant formal economy sectors in the states. And we can also see that if you look at a fairly flat line on the reuse economy until about 2008, which we all know was the beginning of the subprime market crisis, and we see a drastic rise in the reuse sector in the state, which started to drop off with rebound. So it's also some implications for reuse as an adaptation strategy, particularly in rural contexts where traditional market integration isn't so vibrant. So that's what the project is about, and the long-term hope is that we can aggregate using life cycle analyses and input-output analyses, we can aggregate the the total value of the reuse sector in the state and then calculate the mitigation potential as a means to drive policy. Thank you.
You've only been here 3 years, you may not know that the informal motto of Maine is reuse, repair, or go without. For generations.
Yeah, in just talking informally with some of the reuse sector business owners, I have heard that, you know, use it up, wear it out, make do or do without, probably in about 95% of the interviews so far. Yeah, so as a cultural anthropologist, you can imagine there is something about the construction of culture that is intriguing to me. Why Maine? And just, I have lots of hypotheses. The research team does. So is there something
you can point to that's the biggest threshold or impediment to the growth of that economy in Maine?
Of the reuse economy?
Yeah.
Is there one? So we actually did do a survey question on that. What was the big impediment? And it's a systems problem. It's that we have extremely cheap goods because we externalize all the costs associated with production, that it's incredibly cheap and convenient just to go to IKEA and buy a new piece of furniture rather than using it longer. So that was the number one variable, and it makes sense, right? So the project does attempt to model some of these interactions between new virgin production retail and reuse retail, but it's going to be a while before we get there. Thank you, everybody.
All right, good morning, everyone. I'm Sudarshan Chawathai. I go by Chow. I'm a computer scientist. I have a cooperating appointment in the Climate Change Institute. So I'm a computer scientist, so this talk is going to be a little different. By that, I probably mean a little bit more painful, but I'll try to make it a little less painful. That's all I can promise. So this talk is about a tool. So it's not directly talking about climate and earth science and so on. And furthermore, it's about a tool for tool makers. So it's a couple of steps removed from the real product, one might say, in this venue. Also, it's a work in progress, so don't expect something totally amazing, although I have some good stuff to show. But now, some of you may be saying, you rascal, work in progress, you're supposed to only take 3 minutes, and you're taking 10 minutes, what's going on here? So this is where I come to my third point. I have some people to thank for this. And for this, I have to thank Becky, because she very generously gave me 10 minutes. You know, when she sent out the email, I said, oh yeah, 3 minutes as usual. But if there's some time left over, you know, 10 minutes would be nice. And of course, I thought, of course, there wouldn't be any time left over because these things are so busy. And I was very surprised. I got an email message saying, hey, there was some time, so I put you down for 10 minutes. So thank you. But maybe other people might not thank you so much. And then the other question is, how did I get started with all this stuff? And for that, I have to thank Andre, because we were co-teaching ERS 602 last semester, and Andre decided to devote one class to GMT, and so that kind of forced me to take a closer look at it. I mean, I'd heard about it before, but never really looked at it carefully. So those are all the people I would like to thank slash blame. So what is GMT? Many of you probably already used it, but just so that everyone's on the same page. I think it now stands for generic mapping tools. I think a while back it stood for geophysical mapping tools or something like that. Anyway, everyone just calls it GMT. It's a pretty old tool, at least by computer science standards. I mean, not by geologic standards, obviously, but by computer science standards, you know, 1988 is, I don't know, we were, people were excited when they had 10 megabytes on a hard disk in their computer. Megabytes, I mean, if you probably don't even account for megabytes anymore. It was also when we had George Michael and Wham. But never mind. So GMT is a very nice tool. I mean, it's very well designed. It does a good job, especially good job with projections and things like that, which probably most of you know about that. From the computer science point of view, it's interesting because it's sort of a standard Unix design philosophy, which is it uses It consists of a bunch of small programs that each program does a small, well-defined task, and then you put them together. So that's kind of a well-established way of doing things that has many benefits, but I'm not here to praise GMT so much, although it is nice, but mostly to try to fix a few things that I didn't like about it. One of the problems is that it really relies on a lot of intermediate files to do most of its work. And this is not a big issue if you're just writing a small script, but as you start writing bigger and bigger programs, the whole thing turns into a mess. You have to sort of keep track of all your intermediate files, you have to make sure you don't overwrite the wrong one, things like that. This all sounds very easy, but you know, when you have to do it for tens and hundreds of things over and over again, something is almost definitely going to go wrong. The other problem is that it doesn't really have proper data types at the user level. It does the kind of the standard Unix thing, which is it uses strings for pretty much everything. So if you want to pass it an integer, you basically have to convert it to a string, and then someone else is going to convert it back from an integer to a string, which again doesn't sound like a big thing, except you do it 100 times, definitely there's going to be a bug somewhere. Okay, so that's some of the problems with it. It also has a rather quirky syntax, which those of you who have used it will, I think, agree. If not, you can. I would recommend using it. It would be interesting. Well, here's an example from the GMT tutorial. I just picked it up verbatim. I just edited out a few header lines just to make it fit. So this is basically the first example from the tutorial, so presumably one of the simplest ones, and it is really one of the simplest ones. Actually, it's the one that generated the top figure there. Those of you who are used to reading scripts, you know, it's not very challenging. I mean, yeah, why make a big deal about this? A couple of things. One is that you see that it really appends to a temporary file, which is trickier than it seems, because you have to give it some extra options every time you append, except for the last time when you don't give it that option, which again says, okay, so you just remember not to do it the last time. Well, guess what? You keep writing programs doing this. Sooner or later, you're going to screw up. Things are going to get messy. The other thing is that this option syntax is, at least for me, it's a little much. The problem is not just that. I mean, these simple options are easy enough. You know, fine, you just figure out what they mean, and you can look up the manual. But then these other options, they have sort of a language within a language, so to speak. Like this one, you know, 50 plus F7P, that has a very specific meaning. It's easy enough to look it up. So the good news with GMT is that the manual is really good. I mean, it has very good documentation, which if you've been programming, you probably know that is very often not the case. So GMT actually, that's one of the things that attracted me to it, that really does have good documentation. That being said, that's a lot of stuff to read while you're trying to get something done. So this is just, suppose you wanted to figure out what this A option means. The good news is that it's really spelled out, I would say, very well in the documentation. But it's a lot of documentation. I mean, there's like, I forget if I removed the number of lines, but there's 15 more sub-options for this one option, and yeah, there's like 60 more lines in the manual, which again, you say, oh, come on, you know, you gotta read. But this is just for one option. And so this can really get problematic. So again, you know, here are some people who say, "Well, it doesn't bother me. You know, I can deal with programming." Okay, so you might be one of these guys, which, in case you don't know, this means you're a lead hacker. So yes, you know, when you're doing programming, there's always a tendency to say, "Oh, what's the big deal? We can do it. It's not like we have to do it 5 times a day." And so I would like to put here a quote by Alan Curtis, who's a very famous computer scientist. Talks about beware of the Turing carpet. This is one of the folklore quotes, which says that just because you can do it doesn't mean that's the right way to do it, because it's just you're sort of getting caught into this mode. Instead of designing something to be convenient, you're only designing something to be feasible, and these are usually quite different. So some of the desirable features you'd like are things like easy composition, which is also something that's kind of hard to do, because you're doing, the way GMT does things is puts a lot of stuff in temporary files. And so if you want to compose things, you have to compose them through those temporary files, which again, if you think about your composing 4 or 5 functions, somewhere along the line, it's pretty likely one of the temporary files, you'll either use the wrong one, or it will get accidentally deleted, or something weird is going to happen. So we'd like to avoid all those things and use kind of modern features, actually not that modern features of computer programming languages, that kind of help us deal with all this thing. So here I was going to, I'll just very quickly talk about the approach I took of functional programming. I won't actually describe it in detail, even though Nick wanted me to, so you, I guess you can't blame him because I'm going to skip over this part. But functional programming is not the only way to do things, but it's a good way to do things. I won't really get into exactly how it is. But here you can look at this XKCD because why not? It's always good to look at XKCD, I think. So this will tell you a little bit about why I chose to do things the way I did it. It's not the only way to do it, but I think it's a good way. The prime motivation in using Scheme or a Lisp-based language is that it's a programmable programming language that I should have attributed that code. That's actually, it's a folklore code, but it's, I believe, originally attributed to John Ferraro. So let me actually skip forward to, I'm not gonna explain this. It's good stuff though. You can, let me show you some of the cool stuff you can do. So these are your standard arithmetic functions. They mean what you might imagine they mean from their symbols. What I'm doing is I'm composing these pairwise, and then I'm applying each pair to the number 42. I say, why on earth do I want to do that? Well, it's just for demonstration purposes. But what it demonstrates is that we can really treat functions as first-class objects, and we can compose functions just as easily as we can add integers or floating-point numbers. So that's sort of a big part of what makes this thing powerful. So here is how the design of the program works. I'm going to skip over this because I'm basically out of time. Let me just show you the nicer way of doing GMT. Now, you may or may not think this is nicer. I think it's nicer. To me, it's a lot easier to understand. And the other aspect is that some of it is not nice, and that's by design, because if you try to make everything nice at once, it's going to take 6 months, and so you'll never finish. But this way, I only made a little bit of it nice, so I was able to finish in 1 week, and the rest of it I'll do later, or maybe never. But at least someone else can do it. Okay, so I'm going to stop here with my summary and take questions.
So I'm Jacqueline Gill. I have a split position between the School of Biology and Ecology and the Climate Change Institute, and I'm excited to share some new research on a project I've been working on for a while. Really, I'm in just like many of us in this room, I'm inspired by graphs like this one, where we're basically committed to something like up to 4 degrees Celsius warming in the next century, or as I prefer to think about it, one ice age unit, right? So it's the difference between today and the last ice age. So even though 4 degrees might not seem like a lot, it's certainly a lot to the Earth system. And changes or predictions like this have a lot of folks really concerned about how ecological responses will play out in the near future. And we know that novel climates, so novel combinations of temperature and precipitation, are predicted in the next century. Some of those here you can see are centered around the tropics, but essentially we can expect some climatic novelty everywhere around the globe. And we know from ecological theory that without changing anything fundamental to species, you can actually drive novel interactions of, you know, plants, animals, and other constituents of communities. So in this example here, we have, you can pick your two favorite climate variables, and then you might have, say, an orange species and a green species. And if this is the only realized environmental space available, in this particular case, green species and orange species don't overlap, they don't coexist. But all you have to do is really shift that realized environmental space. We can be talking about a paleo climate, or we can be talking about some future model climate. And you can see here that without changing anything fundamental about the biology or the ecology of these species, suddenly you have an interaction where you didn't have one before. And we've recognized these from the past. So what's interesting, though, is that you could really predict a couple of ways in which these ecological communities might have different kinds of functional responses on the landscape. And in the first way, you have a functional replacement. So as new species kind of come into an area, you have new combinations of species. If those new species have the same kinds of ecological functions that the ones they're replacing do, then you're not actually really changing anything fundamental about the ecosystem properties. You're just shuffling the actors, so to speak, but the play remains the same. So in this case, you have dissimilarity increasing here, and through time, there's no real functional response, even though you have community turnover. So the actors, as I said, are shuffling. However, you could also imagine a case where the actors stay the same, but the script changes, right? They're given a different set of lines. And so in this case, you're not actually changing anything fundamental about the community. There's no turnover in species, but there might be shifting ecological responses that are driving ecosystem functions to change, maybe because of changes in precipitation or temperature or even carbon dioxide. And we really don't have a good sense of which of these are likely to play out in the future when it comes to these sorts of novel species interactions or novel ecosystems. And in fact, often novel community and novel ecosystem are terms that are used interchangeably, and you can see here why that might be really problematic. So from a modern ecologist's perspective, we're gonna turn to some data here to kind of really break down why this might be an interesting problem. So this is just the mapped distribution of pollen of the genus Fraxinus here and the genus Picea, so we have ash and spruce. So if you're a modern ecologist, you don't think of these as co-dominants. They don't really live in the same places. They don't really interact as tree species. However, if you were studying these organisms as an ecologist 13,000 years ago, you'd have a very, or if you're a paleoecologist like me, you'd have a very different perspective on the system. Not only would there be a giant ice sheet taking up half the available habitat in North America, but you would see that spruce and ash are overlapping. You'd also see that there are higher concentrations of ash in the past than there are today. And so you get a very different picture of these ecological communities. So we've long recognized these from the pollen record, and the question has really been, what's driving these ecological communities? But which I'm not gonna really talk about today, although there's strong evidence for a combination of novel climates as well as the extinction of ice age herbivores, which is something I've worked on. So, but what I liked about this system is it's a really great test case, sort of a natural experiment in ecological novelty that allows us to ask this question, okay, so we have a novel combination of species here. Did they function differently than modern ecosystems? Can we infer something about their ecosystem properties? All right, so there's really two ways that you can define this idea of ecological novelty. And there's the sort of regional scale, which is how we've typically done it with pollen data, right? So you have a set of taxa in the past, you have a set of taxa that you can compare to in the present, and then you can sort of make matches among those communities and find their closest modern analog, basically anywhere in North America or the world, depending on the scale of your study. But there's also a different way of thinking about ecological novelty from a management perspective, and this is typically how it's been done by, say, someone who has responsibility for a particular site that they have to really take care of. And that's this idea that we know that there's changes in composition through time, right? And there might be some ecological events, and you're always comparing to some modern reference, right? And so there's really two ways to think about this, and I'm gonna apply both of these methodologies to these data sets. And, this is where I'm reminding myself to tell you that the regional scale, as I mentioned, this is a little pollen grain here from a fir tree. So this is reminding me to tell you that this is how paleoecologists working with pollen data have typically approached this question, but there's also this little cute baby panda is, so that I remind you myself to tell you that this is typically how modern managers think about it. So you've got your modern reference community there. We're gonna project something into the future. We're not really sure what's coming from a species perspective as our communities change. But we can use the past to basically see, is there this similar relationship between community composition in terms of species and the ecosystem functions that those species provide? All right, so to do this analysis, we used data from the Neotoma database, which Ben set up nicely yesterday. So we have pretty good coverage for North America in terms of pollen associations. And we're comparing for each time step all of these paleo communities to a series of possible modern matches. So this is that sort of regional scale approach that I told you about. All right, and now to try to elucidate state something about function, we're basically taking a series of plant functional traits. These are properties of plants that are assumed to have a strong relationship with functions of interest. And we know that these are pretty conserved through time. And specifically, we're talking about seed mass, canopy height, and specific leaf area. And so these really capture processes like dispersal, competition, and other kinds of important ecological interactions. And this is an illustration just to really show you that, you know, oftentimes when I talk to contemporary ecologists, the first thing they say is, well, how do you know there hasn't been a lot of change through time, a lot of evolution in these plants? And this is just showing you some leaves of Rhamnaceae from the Eocene compared to some modern ones. And if you, for example, were to look at maple leaves, they haven't really changed much in about 30 million years. So we're pretty confident that these traits are conservative, at least at the time scale that we're looking at, which is the last 20,000 years, 21,000 years. So if they can last over 30 million, 20,000 should be okay. All right, so let's look at some of the data. So first, I'm gonna show you some of the data at the local scale. So this, remember, is we're comparing all possible pollen associations to the same site at the modern at the modern time step, and then sort of back forecasting as we go. So this is 21,000 years to the present. As you go up on this axis, this increases squared core dissimilarity between the paleo community and the modern. So of course it approaches zero as you approach modern, which makes sense. And so what's interesting is if you look at climatic dissimilarity, which we're taking from the CCSM3 paleoclimate simulations, and you look at community dissimilarity, and we've got error here, or variability here in the background, and then the mean as it goes and approaches modern. Community dissimilarity declines as you approach the present, which makes sense. And we don't really have no analog communities up until very recently. So what that's telling us is there's quite a lot of community turnover at an individual site, which makes sense because we had an ice sheet, the ice sheet retreats, lots of species coming in. There's quite a lot of change in the composition of these communities. But what about their ecological functions? All right, so now I've got community dissimilarity at the top and trait dissimilarity at the bottom. And what's really interesting here is that you can see there's a tremendous amount of change in ecological communities, but there's not really a lot of change in their function. So we have lots of new species coming in, but the actual suite of ecological functions doesn't really change on the landscape. So the same kinds of ecological strategies are being employed even by the new species that are arriving. And there's some variability there, but overall, we basically stay, you know, within analog space. Now sort of at the regional scale, which is typically how these data are analyzed in paleo systems, we see something very similar. Interestingly, climatic dissimilarity and community dissimilarity are pretty well mapped out on each other. This is something we've known for quite some time. But now, again, if we look at the relationship, even at the regional scale, between community composition and ecological functions, we see that, you know, with a maybe notable exception here, close to the end of the last ice age, we have pretty much modern analogs for all of our ecosystem functions. And so there's really not a lot of functional turnover. So these are novel communities, but they're not novel ecosystems, which is really interesting. And so I just want to make the final plug that how we think about ecological novelty really is going to scale with the sort of with the problem of interest, right? So from a conservation perspective, a land manager might not care if there's an analog to their ecosystem function somewhere in Alaska or Maine, if they're in, you know, northern Manitoba. They might have a mandate to manage for certain functions in place, right? And so that's important. With that, hopefully there's time for questions. Thanks. Time for questions. Yes?
So I was wondering about whether you can see any signal from loss of top predators, but it would really only be in recent times. So like loss of wolves and so forth in ecosystems, terrestrial ecosystems.
So the question is, you know, do you see evidence of loss of top predators? So I actually have done a lot of work on the loss of large herbivores, many of which were too big to really have been predated. I didn't show this work today, but there is some evidence that loss of large herbivores has cascaded through the system to make these plant communities less resilient to climate change. In terms of the loss of top predators, you don't tend to see those kinds of trophic cascades sort of with the last extinction of megafauna, again, because a lot of these animals are just too big to really have been predated. But there are some really interesting examples of historic trophic cascades that seem to be playing out in terms of vegetation, the most classic one being the relationship between wolves and elk at Yellowstone with the wolf reintroduction. And so certainly these plant communities are sensitive, you know, even at really large spatial or temporal scales, to trophic dynamics. They're not just responding to climate, they're responding to all kinds of other things, including interactions with each other. And that's something I'm really keen on sort of unpacking a little more. Yeah. Any other questions? Thanks.
Hi, I'm Jim Fastick, School of Computing and Climate Change Institute. That was a really fascinating terrestrial session. We now begin the Mars session. I work with Jim Head at Brown University. He's a geologist, geomorphologist, who's interested in climate change on Mars. And as has been mentioned a number of times throughout the talks today, glaciers and ice sheets are sensitive climate indicators, and limitation of working on Mars is that you do everything from top-down aerial photographs, essentially. But in the course of that, many glacial features have been identified, and hopefully we can tell something about the climate. What is this? What advances?
Yes.
Okay. Carbon dioxide glaciers. I've done a lot of work with water glaciers on Mars, but I was asked to do some work on carbon dioxide as a possible explanation for some of these strange-looking features that occur at high latitudes on Mars, and they get the little name high-latitude glaciers, HLGs. Here's an example of one in a crater that is spreading around the peak, the central peak of the glacier. If we look more closely at the features, they're little ridges, they're a certain size, they cross-cut each other, they don't appear to have been modified underlying deposits, and they appear to be very young. They have very few craters on them, so they're fairly young. It's been suggested that they look like drop moraines. These are terrestrial analogs. There's a lot of overlap between the different moraines. They appear to be separate episodes that occurred. They're not a retreat feature, they're separate advance episodes. There aren't many estimates of the thickness, but in this case where this glacier diverged around the peak, they estimate it could be as thick as 400 meters. They're similar to something called lobate debris aprons, which are these kind of parabolic features that occur around mesas. The difference being that the lobate debris aprons still contain ice. These are radar pictures from orbit that show the thickness of the ice underneath these lobate debris aprons. The high latitude glaciers appear to be completely gone. Whatever the material is, it's gone. Various evidence points to the fact that these might have been CO2 glaciers, and I am investigating that process. One of the reasons for this is has to do with the fact that Mars, with no big moon and proximity to Jupiter, experiences Milankovitch signals that are much more extreme than what we see on the Earth. This is a Milankovitch-style calculation of the obliquity changes that Mars has gone through during the last 6 million years, and the obliquity's gone as high as 45 degrees and as low as about 5. So during these big obliquity changes, the climate changes a lot. Now, one of the things that happens during low obliquity is that the carbon dioxide atmosphere freezes out onto the planet's surface. This is obliquity, this is atmospheric pressure, and the atmosphere basically freezes out onto the surface. They get about a meter accumulation of carbon dioxide ice every winter anyway. These low obliquity excursions are about 100,000 years long, and we've had a lot of them over the last 3 million years. One of my authors, co-authors, Jim Head, and another, Chris Lesky, did some preliminary work with CO2 glaciers. Kreslowski is who did that atmospheric work that showed the atmosphere freezes out, but he also did some back of the envelope calculations for whether CO2 glaciers could flow, and he thought they could. What I did was I took the Mars version of the University of Maine ice sheet model and adapted it for a CO2 rheology. EUMISM, for those of you who don't know, is a shallow ice thermomechanically coupled ice sheet model. It works either in the flow line mode or a map plane. What I've done here is use the flow line version. All that EUMISM requires is bed topography, mean annual surface temperature, and net annual accumulation rate. It can calculate basal melt rates. I did not see my CO2 glaciers melt at the bed at any point. So first thing I did was look at a flat bed, kind of to figure out how thick various glaciers could get. So I cooked up a little mass balance scheme where it's positive here and it's negative here, just a simple parabola. And I grew various ice sheets. Here's an example of one with a 200 kilometer accumulation area, and it achieves a thickness of about 160 meters. The mass balance, the thickness, the velocity, and the driving stress for that particular example. Thickness, as I said, reaches about 160 meters. Velocity is maybe 6 meters a year, and driving stress is of a few hundred pascals. So I explored the parameter space, make the accumulation area bigger. I let the accumulation area go all the way up to 2,500 kilometers. My thickness gets a bit bigger there. But even for the widest accumulation area, which is an absolutely ridiculous idea, with a 4,000 kilometer wide carbon dioxide ice sheet, it's only 450 meters thick. Of course, the point of this is that carbon dioxide ice is very soft, even at the temperatures that are encountered in these low obliquity cycles. Next thing I did was look at how this behaves on a slope, because a sloping bed is going to contribute to the driving stress. It'll increase the velocities. And this produces thinner ice sheets. And so as I increase the slope, the thickness of my ice sheet declines rather rapidly. The velocity, of course, has to go up in order to pass that flux through the now thinner ice sheet. And I should note that these are very small angles. This is only a range of a tenth of a degree, but it reduces the thickness by about 60%. Here are the profiles. There's my flatbed profile, 0.05 degrees and 0.1 degree. The ice sheet gets thin fast. So I started off trying to model this on an actual crater. This is the Tooting crater. It's not a high latitude crater, but it had good topography, so I started using that. This is the shape of the crater. I cooked up a similar kind of mass balance pattern for ice accumulating on one face of the crater. This was from the Kreslowski paper that it, CO2 forms on the pole foot facing slope. The slopes here are much bigger, 25 degrees. The glacier grows quite quickly to equilibrium, less than 10,000 years. The mass balance here is positive in this region. The ice surface is barely discernible because the ice is only about 30 meters thick. And the velocities are about 3 meters a year over that steepest part. The crater that I showed you at the beginning that had the diverging flow around the peak, the topography became available for that. And so that this is what the topography across section from A prime to A looks like. Because it kind of diverges around this peak, when I did the modeling, I sort of cut off that peak because the ice is actually diverging around it. This is a flow band version of the model. So here's the bed and surface profiles. We see a little pooling here, kind of upstream of the peak. It gets to be about 70 meters thick there. The velocity is highest over the steep slope, much thinner where it's on the steep slope. Incidentally, just to demonstrate the difference between CO2 ice and water ice, this is the exact same mass balance pattern, of course, at a much warmer temperature for water ice. And so water ice would make a big parabolic profile like this. And the takeaway from this is that that CO2 ice, because it's much thinner and much softer, responds much more to the topography. These are log plots of driving stress for the water case and the CO2 case, log plots of the thickness for water and CO2, and log plots of the velocity, more than two orders of magnitude difference between the two. So the much thinner CO2 ice much more clearly sees the underlying topography. It follows valleys much more accurately than the water ice that kind of floods the landscape and generates its own surface slope. And this manifests in the record where we see these lobe-like features coming out from the source area of the CO2. So in conclusion, the CO2 glaciers provide a reasonable explanation for the high latitude glacier features. Given the soft rheology, they're able to form quickly enough and reach an equilibrium configuration in the relatively short time, 100,000 years, that is available during the obliquity excursions. The other thing is, because they're thin, they never melt at the bed, and I don't know what a melting CO2 glacier would do, blow itself up. They're going to be cold-based, and cold-based glaciers don't leave much of an imprint except for their moraines, which we see very clearly. And their thinness says that they're much more influenced by the topography. As an aside, the current mass of the Martian atmosphere at 6 millibars is 2.5 × 10^16 kilograms. If you freeze that all out and distribute it over the landscape, it would make a circular ice sheet 400 kilometers in diameter. And this actually, this area is actually the order of the observed CO2 footprints that we see now on the planet. Thank you. That's the end of the NARA session, so we can now move on. Any questions?
We have time for one quick question.
Yeah. Quick question was, you said they get a meter of CO2 ice every winter?
Yeah.
And who is that?
Oh, the Martians. They live under the polar caps.
Oh, okay.
Every year the atmospheric pressure actually drops significantly during, I forget if it's the southern winter or the northern winter, I get them confused. But one of the polar caps experiences a approximately 1 meter deposit of CO2 ice every winter. And in the springtime, it begins to sublimate away. Because it's transparent, the sunlight goes through it, heats the bottom. It begins to blow gas out through cracks. It entrains dust, and it blows these black spots out onto the surface of the still existing CO2 ice, as the CO2 ice melts away, the black spots disappear. These were originally called spiders, and they had no idea what they were, but this is the mechanism that they figured out. It's little geysers of CO2 gas coming out from melting CO2.
And do they leave a footprint underneath, though, if they're moving?
Well, as soon as the CO2 disappears, the dark dust blends back into the dust that's underneath it. It only shows as a dark signature when it's being blown out onto the white surface of the CO2 ice. And so these spiders would appear and they would disappear as soon as the CO2 ice melted away. And it took them a while to figure out what was going on. That's their model of the spiders.
All right, thank you, Dr. Mastin. And thank you, everyone, for participating.